going. If I could have everyone's attention, please. It's my great pleasure today to welcome our speaker. I want to begin by thanking the School of History, Philosophy, and Religion, our co-sponsors, the Program on Ethics, Society, and Environment, and the Citizenship and Crisis Initiative here at Oregon State University. Our speaker today is Stephen Gardiner, Professor Stephen Gardiner from the University of Washington. Very happy to have him here. I'll say just a few brief words about his background and then turn it over to him. Steve studied as an undergraduate, I learned today, science at Oxford University, and then went to University of Colorado at Boulder to take up the study of environmental philosophy and continue his study of ancient philosophy at the time. He took his PhD later from Cornell University and has been doing great work ever since. I was trying to think about if there were positions before you came to the UW. But in any case, now he's at the University of Washington, where he's doing good work. I want to present some of the important work that he's done. Reaching into the back catalog, I pulled out my copy of a book he's edited, Virtue Ethics, Old and New. He is a real expert in that area. But really, the contributions he's made are outstanding in the field of environmental philosophy. And I'll start here with his tremendously influential book, A Perfect Moral Storm, The Ethical Tragedy of Climate Change by Oxford University Press. And then he is the lead editor of this collection, really of the most important readings in climate ethics, along with Simon Caney, Dale Jameson, and Henry Hsu, also from Oxford University Press. And most recently, he has completed a book with David Weisbach from Oxford University Press, debating climate ethics. Important work, and I think will be useful for pedagogy. He and I have also recently completed, and will have an event tomorrow, a book launch. I hope you can have some time to make it at 2 o'clock in the afternoon on the Oxford Handbook of Environmental Ethics with 42 different chapters covering all the important areas. Steve's work has focused on a lot of things in environmental ethics, but among them, and most primarily perhaps, a concern with future generations and the specter of anthropogenic climate change, the kind of damage it will do, and the kind of biases that we have in confronting this problem. So with no further ado, I'll turn the floor over to Stephen Gardiner.
Thank you very much, Alan. That was a very generous introduction. So now I get to live down to lower expectations. So today I wanted to talk to you about this ongoing project that I have, thinking about what to do about the issue of future generations given the plight in which we find ourselves. And I'm starting with some quotations from politicians. Probably that's my way of trying to diminish the initial negative reaction to my bold proposal that will come later. So Mary Robinson, who was the United Nations Secretary General's Special Envoy for Climate Change, said in 2010, the scope of these problems, climate problems, and of the action required to treat them reach beyond previous human challenges. Yet in the 16 years since the Framework Convention was signed, global negotiations have proceeded at a glacial pace. We have collectively failed to grasp the scale and urgency of the problem. Climate change shows up countless weaknesses in our current institutional architecture. Similarly, Connie Hedegaard said in 2009 in the run-up to the Copenhagen meeting, at the time she was Danish Minister for Climate Energy, but then she became the EU Commissioner for Climate Action. She said, if the whole world comes to Copenhagen and leaves without making the needed political agreement, then I think it's a failure that is not just about climate. Then it's the whole global democratic system not being able to deliver results in one of the defining challenges of our century. And that should not be a possibility. Right. So those are the slides I'm supposed to say. Gardiner didn't just make this up. And people inside the system think there are real issues as well. So what am I going to try to do here? Well, I think the climate change poses a profound ethical challenge to us, and that if we keep evading this challenge, which I think we've been doing for 25 years or so, then we're not going to get effective policy. So I think we need a fundamental paradigm shift in how we're thinking about the problem. So specifically, some things I'm going to talk about a bit in this presentation are, first, that the climate change problem is usually misdiagnosed, in my view, as a traditional tragedy of the commons. Second, that this obscures two deeper ethical challenges, the tyranny of the contemporary, which I'll focus on, and then my wider account of the perfect moral storm. I think addressing these challenges head on, by calling for the things signaled in the title, namely a global constitutional convention focused on future generations. And then I want to just propose some initial guidelines for the construction of the convention, mainly to facilitate further discussion among those, perhaps the very few, who are going to turn out to be sympathetic to the idea. So let's start with the idea of the paradigm shift being needed. Here's the traditional way in international relations, economics, and allied disciplines of thinking about climate change as a problem. Think of it as a traditional tragedy of the commons, which is connected to the paradigm of the prisoner's dilemma in ways I talk about elsewhere. It's a traditional tragedy of the commons played out between nation states, where the background assumption is that these nation states adequately represent the interests of their populations in perpetuity across the long term. Right. Specifically on this model, we've got a conflict between two different attitudes on the part of the individual states. So on the one hand, they accept, according to this hypothesis, that climate change is bad for them, or that allowing it to continue is bad for them, and so cooperation is needed to address it. And it will be in their interests for everyone to cooperate. On the other hand, when they start thinking just as individual states, they face these incentives to defect. Right? And we get the paradoxical result that even though everyone agrees that collectively it would be a good thing to do something about climate change, when acting as individual states, they all defect, and everyone ends up worse off than they would otherwise be. That's the usual understanding. It's a powerful kind of understanding. The tragedy of the commons model is very powerful. It's theoretically elegant. Lots of people think it illuminates many real-world problems, including many environmental problems. But part of my worry is that when we apply it to climate change and in some other cases, it's one of those situations where if what you've got is a hammer, everything looks like a nail, right? Because I don't accept this analysis. And so why do I think it's the wrong analysis? And in particular, it's the wrong kind of tragic analysis. So some kind of tragic analysis is better. What is it? Well, we can start with the thought that in a tragedy of the commons, really what goes on looks as though it's self-inflicted, self-destructive behavior. Right? There are these things, states, that think various kinds of cooperation are good for them, but then defect in ways that harm them. Right? They harm themselves through their behavior. Right. It's true that many people reject the tragedy of the commons analysis for other problems because they think it's too pessimistic, in particular too pessimistic about motivation and in ways which affect how we think about real world cases. But my criticism is that the tragedy is overly optimistic, right? In particular, it assumes away the intergenerational dimension. What do I mean by this? Well, you'll notice on the previous slide, I highlighted the assumption that nation states adequately represent the interests of their populations in perpetuity across time, across at least many decades, probably many centuries. Think about that assumption for a moment. Nation states adequately represent the interests of their populations in perpetuity. I'm wondering what your reaction is. My reaction is that that claim has difficulty passing a very technical philosophical test, which I call the laugh test, right? And by that I mean it's so, you know, compared to, in the domain of just sort of normal common sense thinking about the world, it's such an outrageous claim, right, that you can barely hear it without laughing. You would laugh if it wasn't such a serious issue, perhaps, right? Doesn't mean it's necessarily false, because we maybe believe a lot of things that we shouldn't believe, right? Maybe someone could give us strong arguments
why we should believe it, but they would have to give us strong arguments, right? We shouldn't accept this one on its face because it just flies in the face of so much of what we commonsensically believe about how the world works. So that's an obvious defect in the model, that its basic assumption can't pass the laugh test, right? I think. We need to hear a lot more. Another defect of the model is that it gives us impression that we're just dealing with self-destructive and self-inflicted behavior. But once you realize that, in the intergenerational dimension, once you realize that's there, and many of the harms that will be caused by climate change will occur much later in time but be caused by people acting earlier in time, you realize, well, actually, this doesn't look like a paradigm of self-destructive, self-inflicted behavior. Instead, it looks as like doing bad things to other people who can't, in particular, strike back at you, right, because they're in the future. And then lastly, I'm going to argue that my analysis helps predict the mixed diagnosis. So the rival, more persuasive analysis predicts that we would be inclined to see things optimistically and indulge in assumptions that don't pass laugh tests. Okay. So what is the rival analysis? Well, unfortunately for everybody, there's a big book that I have that talks about this at painstaking length. But here's the quick intuitive idea. The analysis is called the perfect moral storm, and that's meant to draw an analogy with the famous book by Sebastian Junger and the perhaps more famous film starring George Clooney, which is all based on a true story, the story of a fishing boat that's caught at sea at the intersection of independently powerful storms, any one of which might be enough to sink it and destroy it in isolation, but when they come together, it becomes a profound, overwhelming kind of challenge. And in fact, in the real life, the fishing boat does perish, right? It's too much for it to handle. So the sense of the analogy here is that with climate change, we face a situation where various challenges to ethical action come together and in ways liable to throw us off course. So the problem is genuinely global. This is the most familiar way we look at climate change as a problem, right? There's a spatial dispersion of causes and effects, I say. It doesn't matter where the emissions originally come from on the surface of the planet. They quickly go up into the atmosphere, become well mixed, and start affecting climate anywhere and everywhere. Right. Then there's the, so that's very noticed. It's important within that spatial analysis that there are skewed vulnerabilities, however, that by and large, to a large extent, the bulk of the emissions are coming from the more developed places, which are richer and so better able to defend themselves against climate threats, whereas the effects are, the bad things are disproportionately located in poor countries, partly because they're poor and so not very able to protect themselves. So those who are most responsible are least vulnerable, those who are least responsible are most vulnerable. That's a big moral problem. We like to talk about those dimensions, but I want to talk about two other dimensions in particular today, the intergenerational dimension, and then the problem of moral corruption. So another storm, another thing that might throw us off track is that there is distribution of causes and effect across time, and in dramatic kinds of ways. And this gives us the tendency, or the temptation, I should say, to pass the buck for what we're doing now, not just as in the global storm towards the poor, but in the intergenerational storm towards the future. Right? We take goodies now and pass many of the worst costs of those onto the future. There's a parallel kind of storm involving the dispersion of causes and effects across species that I won't mention here, and another storm that involves a coming together of lots of areas where we don't have robust theories, let's put it that way. There are lots of things that come together for climate change where how to think about them is not so clear to us, or at least not so deep in terms of theoretical defenses. And this includes intergenerational ethics itself, but also what to say about international justice, scientific uncertainty, situations where what we do will affect who exists and what they prefer, right? These are hard things to talk about philosophically, and also our general relationship with animals and the rest of nature. And I'm going to say that all this, the coming together of these various storms, results in another problem of moral corruption. Let's come back to that in a minute. So let's talk about the temporal dispersion of causes and effects. The main greenhouse gas is carbon dioxide. That's the one we worry about most. It's not the only one to worry about, but it is the one we worry about most. Even on typical estimates of the IPCC in the early days, people would say, molecules of carbon dioxide, once we've emitted them, stay in the atmosphere the order of a few hundred years. But then subsequent work, particularly emphasized by David Archer, who's a climate scientist at the University of Chicago, said this disguises something, right? Disguises something important, which is that carbon dioxide emissions have a long tail. Here's what he says. The carbon cycle of the biosphere will take a long time to completely neutralize and sequester anthropogenic carbon dioxide. For the best guess cases, we expect that 17% to 33% of the fossil fuel carbon will still reside in the atmosphere 1,000 years from now, decreasing to 10 to 15% at 10,000 years and 7% at 100,000 years. And so as he suggests as a heuristic for how you might think about the impact of this, the mean lifetime of fossil fuel carbon dioxide is about 30 to 35,000 years. So once we've put stuff in the atmosphere, other things being equal, it's just staying up there a very long time, impacting the future for quite a while. And of course, the temptation that I briefly mentioned before is something like this. There's a structural problem that I call the tyranny of the contemporary, right? Where I'm sort of drawing a little bit of analogy with a more familiar notion in political philosophy of the tyranny of the majority. So under a tyranny of the contemporary, here's a case you might worry about. There are benefits now to us, the current generation, of a certain kind of behavior. Perhaps these are even modest benefits. And the costs, or a large proportion of them, come later, and particularly the severe ones, to them, those in future generations. What's the temptation? Well, it's to behave unethically with respect to these benefits, right? To take way too many of them than could possibly be justified, right, in the current generation. In particular, because the ones one takes are going to involve really severe costs to people coming later. This isn't the only part of the problem, though, the simple benefits now, costs in the future, violating any ethically defensible standards. The problem is iterated. It comes about for each generation as it comes to hold the reins of power and decide whether it's going to emit more carbon dioxide, say. Right? So each generation faces the temptation, and so that if each succumbs to the temptation, you get accumulating costs in the future on future generations, possibly resulting in catastrophe. And then worse still, perhaps, you might even get an escalation of the moral problem. What do I have in mind here? Well, at a certain point, if enough generations have, say, polluted enough, things get really bad in the future. And people in the future face extreme risks on the ground. Here's the situation or a choice that might confront them. Shall we pollute more? Shall we ramp up our emissions in order to boost production in our generation, in order to better protect the people who are around now? If we do that, we know that future generations are going to be even worse off. But maybe we're entitled to do it out of self-defense. We know they'll be entitled to do it out of self-defense as well, and so the whole thing gets really radically out of control. You get the equivalent of an intergenerational arms race. In the book, I bring this up because, you know, I found too many people were telling me, well, once things get bad, right, we'll clearly act and act for the best. And I said, I'm not sure we want to wait for things to get bad, because actually we might act and act for the worst in the long term. Second thing I said I was going to emphasize is this problem of moral corruption. So think about it. You're in this perfect moral storm where there are all these temptations to behave badly, passing the buck to the poor, especially to future generations, to the rest of nature as well. Here's another temptation you face. Let's find ways of talking about our problem that don't highlight that we're taking advantage, that we're indulging in all these temptations. Right? That's the problem of moral corruption. Dennis Thompson tells us that in the tradition of political theory, corruption is a disease of the body politic. Like a virus invading the physical body, hostile forces spread through the political body, enfeebling the spirit of the laws and undermining the principles of the regime. Core meanings of corruption here, I think, is distortion, is an altered form for the worse, and something immoral or dishonest, especially something of that sort that involves the exploitation of a position of power or trust for personal gain. And the particular issue I have in mind here is this one, that there's a threat to the discourse, namely to the ways in which we talk and think about the climate problem. We like to find ways of talking and thinking about the problem that don't make clear that we're indulged in vicious forms of buck passing. Right. So are there some signs that this worry about the problem of moral corruption is a live one? I think there are. I think that there's clearly a risk of what I call shadow solutions, attempts to deal with the problem that don't really deal with the problem, and in fact deflect our attention from what the problem really is. I argue in the book that the Kyoto Protocol looks like a shadow solution. If you look into it, it looks as though it was only ever designed to achieve reductions that would have been achieved anyway at the time it was agreed upon, right? It agreed to put in place a future that they thought was already going to happen if they did nothing about climate change. So that's an odd one. And then subsequent approaches in Copenhagen and in Paris involve pledges to do things, and in the Paris case, introduced with lots of fanfare, we've made great progress. But mere voluntary pledges in a scenario in international climate policy where we have good reason to believe the big thing that hasn't worked over time is voluntary pledges. Right? Voluntary agreements haven't got us very far. Let me move on. So there are actually different ways, different things that could be driving the perfect moral storm, and in particular this tyranny of the contemporary problem that I'm worried about. One, the most obvious, is just simple ruthlessness. At bottom, the current generation is just prepared to be ruthless, exploit its temporal power, and take advantage of the future to get benefits. Some people in international relations find this view very tempting, I think, because they're realists. They think that's what we always do at the national level. So maybe why not do it? Why not expect it to occur at the generational model? There are still things to say in climate policy if you have that interpretation. Many people are spending a great deal of time trying to persuade us it would actually be in our interest, even our generational interest, to do something about climate change, right? That the self-interest calculation, as it were, turns out in favor of being green. I think there's nothing wrong with trying to make an argument that it turns out that way. I just think it would be morally deeply problematic to insist that it's only if it turns out that way that we should do something. Right? I think there's a moral imperative not to get engaged in a tyranny of the contemporary, say. It'd be nice if getting out the tyranny of the contemporary would actually turn out to be good for us, turn out not to be a real tyranny of the contemporary. That would be nice, but it can't be our central reason. The current generation can't hold the future hostage by saying, we'll do something to prevent climate change if it would benefit us to do so. Another kind of approach is shallowness. People try to argue, well, all this talk of self-interest, especially at the level of generations, it rests on a very narrow and ultimately fragile sense of self-interest anyway. Right? Very narrow, short-term economic consumption load account of self-interest. And we should just repudiate that. And then we would realize that green lifestyles, say, are good for us, and so there's no self-interest reason really to pursue the ruthless strategy. And here, people argue that we should educate people, exhort that they should lead cleaner lifestyles and so on, and encourage a shift in cultural norms. I think each of these first two drivers of the perfect moral storm play a role. They have some explanatory value, and talk of solutions of or strategies of these forms makes some sense. Right? But I actually think that the most important one is the third one, right? The third driver, which I have called here obliviousness. So here the issue is, suppose we have, at least many of us, concern for future generation, including strong ethical concerns for future generations. Still, it's not clear institutionally how these concerns would be registered in political life or social life more generally, and how they would actually succeed in having some force against other institutional drivers of change, like short-term economic concerns. So another way of putting it, it's easy to look around and see why people's or how short-term economic concern might be furthered in society through things like markets and short-term democratic election cycles and so on. It's much harder to see how intergenerational concern, even if people have it and it's very strong, would have any sort of impact, and in particular, how it would have enough impact to stand against those institutions that promote the short-term and the narrowly economic. So if you think this is the problem, right, that there's a kind of institutional gap, then your strategy is going to be something like, well, we need some institutional reform here. We need some institutions that will actually, if you like, stand up for our concern for future generations, and not just narrowly stand up, but have some bite against the other institutions that favor the short-term and the narrowly economic. So surprisingly enough, that's how we get to the road to a constitutional convention. So here's something I said at the beginning of the previous book. Sometimes the best way to make progress in solving a problem is to clarify what the problem is. So now you've realized I've just spent about 10 minutes, 15 minutes sucking you into a way of thinking, right? And part of the thought is, if you have that way of thinking, if you think this is a problem, it's just starting really from the failure of the laugh test, right? Then you should already be interested in taking the next step, which is, well, what kind of institutional reform do we need? So in some places I say, think of it as baby steps, right? Taking you a place maybe you don't want to go, because I find at first glance nobody wants to talk about a constitutional convention and global institutional reform and all this stuff. It seems scary and unrealistic. But the first baby step was just, well, I've just told you a story about what the problem looks like, right? And based on that story, it looks as though we might have to take a step in this direction. Okay. So the lessons of what came before were just, okay, climate change is one instance of the perfect moral storm, and I put an emphasis on the tyranny of the contemporary. I think there actually could be other ones, right, and that will be important for one point later. I suggested there are multiple roots, you know, the ruthlessness, the shallowness, the obliviousness, and so on. But I've said I think we need to focus on this institutional problem and the intergenerational gap, and in particular the hostility of current institutions towards anything other than the short-term and narrowly economic. You might say that's to overstate it a bit, but that's the core idea. So we need to augment existing institutions, especially for future generations. Then we need to integrate somehow the new institutions, if we need them, with the older institutions and make the system as a whole work, right, effectively together. And then finally, I would say in this part, we need to acknowledge that there is uncertainty about certain aspects. Some of it's some empirical uncertainty about exactly what's going to happen to whom and when under climate change. But there's also theoretical uncertainty. A lot of areas come together where we don't know exactly what to say. But of course, all this uncertainty in this presence of the theoretical storm poses a threat when there's this problem of moral corruption. Right? The threat is that we'll be very, very interested in all the uncertainty, and surreptitiously assume that the uncertainty gives us strong reasons not for doing anything, in particular not do anything that would stop us from benefiting from the tyranny of the contemporary, right? I say we have to confront that issue, the issue of the theoretical and practical uncertainty, head on by thinking about how to design institutions that can cope with the level of uncertainty that we actually have. So this suggests two projects. We'll have to find out what would a revised institutional system actually look like, and how can we develop an achievable path towards such a system, including when we don't yet know what the system should look like. Right? We don't have ideal theories to just plonk in place and implement. Right? And I want to insist very strongly, that's part of our issue, right? Rather than that, it's just a block to solutions, right? Because we have to take seriously what our problem is, I think. And if we take our worries about not having ideal theories that look good yet seriously, that should inform how we approach the whole problem. So, okay, a global constitutional convention. What's the idea? The idea is that we, which means various things here, concern individuals, interested community groups, national governments, and transnational organizations, should initiate a call for a global constitutional convention focused on future generations. There's a procedural component here. It's a call to action. That's a call for something. That's trying to engage a range of actors. It's based on this claim that they have or should at least take on a set of responsibilities for filling the institutional gap. And there's a view here about how to go about discharging those responsibilities. And it has a substantive component. We're going to focus on the Constitutional Convention at the global level. But it's fairly open in how it describes the terms. Right? There's nothing very detailed here about exactly what the Constitutional Convention would look like. Because in the background is the next sort of small step, baby step, is the idea, well, when we look at the perfect moral storm scenario, it looks like key aspects of our problem are is the problem's global, it's intergenerational, and it's ecological, right? And the intergenerational global coordination looks like an essential part of what's problematic here, right? So it makes it pretty natural to say, well, we need a constitutional convention, right? We need some to convene something that will try to deal with that. Actually, I'm going to skip over these. I'm going to say just something quick about the attractive features. One attractive feature, I think, is that actually the proposal is based in a deep political reality. Right? There's nothing weird or out of step with the nature of the problem here behind the proposal, right? The proposal actually responds very directly to things like climate change is very serious. We have persistent political inertia surrounding more modest initiatives, including the UNFCCC process, Kyoto, Copenhagen, and now Paris, right? The proposal calls attention to the heart of the problem, namely the failures of the current system, the need for alternatives, and the background issue of we need to take responsibility for this problem. And then the proposal is ambitious but not alienating, I think. One thing it doesn't do is just succumb to despair about the whole issue, which one could do if one took the perfect moral storm or indeed the tragedy of the commons thing too seriously, right? And it doesn't needlessly polarize from the outset, right? It hasn't yet made distinctive proposals about what a global constitutional convention should decide, right? What kind of system it should put in place. Leaves that completely open at this point, right? I'm going to say some more things in a bit about how to fill in, but at the moment, we're just at the level of we need to discuss how to deal with the problem given that it has this kind of shape. Right? And so I think it's a promising candidate to serve as the subject of a wide overlapping political consensus, at least among those who care about future generations. But it would be nice to have a little more depth to the idea. And this I view as sort of the third baby step, right? So you could get off this, I should have thought of a better analogy. I was gonna say this train, but steps aren't train. You could at least get off this path, right, earlier. But I'm encouraging, you know, if you want to get off a certain step, don't forget the steps you already took. Right? So you might disagree with everything I have to say about the guidelines for a constitutional convention now, But I'm going to encourage you, if that's going to be your view, to think to yourself, well, okay, but I was, hopefully, on board with Steve up through the first two steps. Or even if you're on board with Steve on the first step, right, you need to come up with some proposal that's going to deal with the problem as I see it. You might not be on board with me on the first step, and then I'm in trouble. But any of the others, I think I'm in good shape. And since part of the first step was just the laugh test, which most people laughed, right, I think you're with me a little bit. Okay. So, So what I'm going to do now is talk about what I think might be some guidelines for how to think about the Global Constitutional Convention. And I view this as an internal debate, right? Now we're talking in the vein of those who have been interested in the first two steps. And they think, okay, what are we going to do about this? And we might disagree about how to proceed here, but that I welcome that kind of internal debate. I think that's the sort of debate we should have. So here's some characteristics, I think. And they're going to start small and get, you know, more radical, though I think none of them are that radical when you really think about it. Again, baby steps. First thing, right, the relational characteristics of the convention. First one, autonomy. Any global constitutional convention should have considerable autonomy from other institutions, and especially from those dominated by factors that generate or facilitate the tyranny of the contemporary. Right. So they should have enough autonomy from, say, market systems or national governments that they don't just repeat the emphasis on the short term and the narrowly economic. Right. If they don't have enough autonomy, then what's the point? Right. Because we're not going to get anywhere. Secondly, however, any global constitutional convention should be to some extent accountable to other major institutions, but they should also be accountable to it, right? We wouldn't want to say, well, concern for future generations is the only salient concern in the world, and so this institution, the Global Constitutional Convention, should have a simple veto over everything else that happens, right? It's got to be a more complicated relationship than that. We also, though, shouldn't say that those other institutions have a veto over it, because some of the things that need to happen might involve limiting the powers of those other institutions, if it's ever going to work, right? So there's going to be a tricky, interesting relationship of mutual accountability going on here. Third one, functional adequacy. Seems kind of obvious, but I think actually is starting to be pretty radical in context. The Global Constitutional Convention should be constructed in such a way that it's highly likely to produce recommendations that are functionally adequate to the task. Right? It actually has got to be capable of doing what we ask it to do. Right? Because otherwise, it's just talking for no purpose. And why do I insist on this and think it's radical? When I think of people who've kind of gestured a little bit in this direction, I'm thinking of the UN Secretary General's proposal a couple of years ago that there should be a High Commissioner for Future Generations. Right? That's the level at which we should confront this problem. I'm thinking in the face of this massive perfect moral storm, tyranny of the contemporary that's been going on for 25 years, appointing another, let's face it, fairly minor bureaucrat in the UN system to go and rah, rah, rah for future generations is not really responsive to the gravity of the task in front of us. Similarly, on a related issue, when the Royal Society in the UK was considering what to do about the governance of geoengineering, right, in particular things like spraying stuff in sulfates in the stratosphere to cool down the Earth, right, which from my point of view involve issues like taking control of the whole planetary system, at least around the climate metrics, right, the Royal Society suggested, well, this is an issue that maybe someone needs to take into account, maybe the UN Commission on Sustainable Development. I'm betting almost everybody in this room knows almost nothing about the UN Commission on Sustainable Development, right? Let alone has any reason to believe that it has the sort of institutional profile and power and even resources to manage a problem like spraying sulfates in the stratosphere to take control of global temperature, right? So I think these are manifestly functionally inadequate. Right. So actually, this requirement that seems kind of stupid at first because it's just so obvious, right, turns out to have real bite in the real world because nobody else is thinking big enough in a way. Okay, second sort of set of guidelines for the convention. I think that the convention should aim to cover things at a very broad, to cover a very broad range of global and intergenerational issues. It should be comprehensive, and it should be focused on confronting such issues at a foundational level, and to recommend institutional reform accordingly. This is also starting to get a bit radical, because what people like to do in international affairs is to locate, even when things seem relatively successful, locate very subject-specific, narrowly defined collaboration. Whereas I think, no, the framework, the Constitutional Convention on Future Generations should try to look at things very broadly and see what the roots are and try to confront them over time. And secondly, something flowing a little bit out of that, perhaps, there's this guideline that the convention should try to think about establishing bodies, institutions that will have some standing authority. It shouldn't be issue specific. Shouldn't aim to just promote something issue specific, nor something just temporary, right? Its focus should be on the establishment of institutions that try to deal with these issues over the long term. And one of the reasons for that is because I think we'd want to deal with some of the issues facing future generations in a proactive way. Suppose people were to identify, right, a set of threats that could emerge over the next, you know, few decades or 100 years to future generations that might be like climate change, might be foundational. If there are institutions in place that were charged with protecting future generations, they would, for example, insist that a modest amount of research money be devoted to the investigation of such threats because of their profound implications for future generations. All right, now we're starting to get even more controversial, right? The composition. What should the Global Constitutional Convention actually look like? Right. Well, who should be at it? Well, I think there should be some attempt at generational representation. So the thought is that there should be a way of representing those expected to live during different time periods as parts of different birth cohorts. So we shouldn't just ask all the old guys to show up and debate the Constitutional Convention and discuss how it's going to perform, right? We got to have representation of different generations in particular, because part of our structural problem involves the generational aspect. Next one, when we think about what representation we want, I think we want representatives that represent a suitably long time horizon over at least centuries and probably millennia. And maybe we need some provision for representation that that goes even longer for some issues that merit it. So we're not just trying to represent the current generation, the current generations that happen to be around on the planet now, right? There's got to be some way within the Constitutional Convention of trying to represent the concerns of those who will come after, and indeed far after. Right. So that's the thing that's got to be thought about. And then next one, I think the representation should be designed to reflect large-scale ecological realities. So shouldn't initially be thought of as, say, representing nations or cities or current things that seem geopolitically salient, right? One reason is, well, there are plenty of other things in society that represent all those things. But the other thing, another thing that's perhaps more interesting is we might expect over time for the relevance of those current groupings to change, right? And become, to sort of recede from the point of view of ethical relevance. Sometimes because they simply cease to exist over time, but sometimes for more interesting reasons, like given patterns of migration, then the idea that, you know, each country should be representing the interests of its future citizens might not be quite right as to what will actually occur over centuries. Right? Think back 1,000 years ago or more, you know, in Europe, my family hails from Britain, but more than 1,000 years ago, you start to get into that question of, well, where were they, you know, were they part of, who knows, I don't know, were they part of the Anglo-Saxon migration, the Viking migration, some earlier migrations, you know, the Roman. So if you're asking yourself for certain periods of time, well, maybe what you should be trying to represent is these things that matter from the point of view of your problem, namely large-scale ecological realities rather than current political realities, even those that last decades, perhaps centuries. The last one is a bit of a cheat in a way, but I think it's a cheat in the way that everyone is going to have to cheat a little bit, at least at this stage. A guideline for the convention is that it should consider how best to contain human activities and influence, including the influence of the intergenerational institutions themselves, in light of wider concerns for the non-human world and humanity's general role in the universe, you might say. Right? There are some issues about what are the boundaries of proper human activity and concern in relation to other members of the natural world, but also just in general. And this seems to be something that the convention should speak to. What's the scope of human activity here? All right, how am I doing? I've got a bunch of objections. What I'm going to do is I'm going to save a couple of them for some of them later, just to give you a couple. And I can't remember what order I put them in, so I'm going to flick and pick a couple that I want to focus on here. Okay, first objection, I do want to say just something about, right? Initial knee-jerk reaction. Steve, you've just given us a brief for world government, some overriding authority that's going to be, you know, very dictatorial, right, and is very dangerous from the political point of view. I think this is a very understandable kind of objection, though I think it probably overreaches in this case. Right? And part of the reason I think it overreaches is that I think, while on the one hand it's true that there, from the point of view of solving the problem, there'd be some desirable features of a highly powerful centralized global authority, right? There would be some attraction to that because you need to act for the sake of this problem, so you need some power. Part of the problem is no one has the power to stop this problem in the global system as we currently have it, right? So there's bound to be some interest in that. But on the other hand, right, we also have concerns, including in, you know, traditional political philosophy, about things getting, you know, entities getting too powerful and the need to constrain them against obvious standing threats, including the threat of creating a monopoly of state power that is unaccountable to anyone, right? But that just means we have to think about how to generate the right kind of institutions for future generations, and think about issues like separation of powers in that context. Because after all, note that I said earlier, there will be mutual accountability between different kinds of institutions. Right? And part of the way you might think about mutual accountability is in these terms, and in particular, that you might need sufficient preservation of existing institutions to serve as a block to overreach by whatever the intergenerational ones are. Second objection is time frame. Right? People will naturally say, oh, but you started out talking about climate change. We just don't have time for any of this dramatic, you know, stuff that you've just been talking about. Problem is just too urgent. So let's talk about, you know, real policy and not get distracted by this kind of project. Well, I have a number of responses to this. One is that actually, since I think we might face more of these big intergenerational problems and more perfect moral storms over time that future generations might, maybe even in our generation, then there would be a point to thinking about these institutional proposals, even if it wasn't going to work for climate change, even if we didn't have enough time. Right, so that's number one. Second one, it might actually help for climate change, because there's nothing about the proposal that's intrinsically antagonistic towards other attempts to solve the climate problem. And in fact, you might think if existing institutions knew that the Global Constitutional Convention was going on and there was going to be an imposition over time of new institutions, that might give them just the kick they needed to focus their minds and do something about the climate change problem. Right. The third is that I question the implicit assumption that the Constitutional Convention necessarily involves a commitment to a very long process. After all, the US Constitutional Convention took a few months and its recommendations were ratified and implemented within a few years. This is probably more complicated, but still, why assume that it's going to take forever? And third, right, and somewhat related to this, I think proposals here need to be compared on a level playing field. Usually what people have in mind when they say, oh, this is just going to take too long, is that the alternative is to continue with the UNFCCC process, right? But that's already taken more than 25 years, right? And it's not delivering. So why are we blocking other proposals on the grounds that they will take too long? We need to be fair and comparative about these things. The next objection is it's unfeasible, right? In our context, we're just not going to be able to do it. This is a real worry, of course, because it might well be that contemporary institutions that are very short-term, narrowly economic, and so on, and have other political things going on with them, right, are just so deeply flawed that you're not going to be able to have a global constitutional convention. Anyway, that's a possibility. My worry about that, though, is that that applies equally to any proposal that's likely to work, to confront any aspect of this problem, right? So it's very easy to make the argument that current institutions are just so powerful and so biased towards acting on this problem that nothing can be done. But we even here, sorry, even here, started singing for some reason. Even here, we have to have some even-handedness, because when one gets really depressed about the prospects from action, the main proposal that emerges for doing something is geoengineering, of the sort I mentioned before, spraying sulfates in the stratosphere. Right. So that's what people actually assume we're going to do if we can't do anything conventional in policy and we can't do the Global Constitutional Convention. But notice that even that, there are big questions about how socially and politically available those options are. People assume that, they at least initially assume, somebody just sprays stuff up there. Right? And they generally assume if they're in the US, it's going to be the US that sprays the stuff up there. So it's all good. There are no institutional barriers, right? But that assumption doesn't really survive very long when you start thinking about it. Right? I mean, one is, obviously, if we're talking about something that's going to happen this century, maybe in the latter half of the century, there's no particular reason to assume it'll be the US that does it. There'll be some other competitive states that even now we can see might be the ones even more likely to do it. Right? But then that starts to put our head in a better place. If we start thinking about what other countries are doing it, particularly ones that are geopolitically powerful in certain ways competitors to the US, then it seems like, well, actually, how socially politically available is it? Right? How are you going to deal with the sources of conflict? To choose the obvious contemporary examples, if China or Russia takes control of the global climate system, how is the US going to react? There's a lot to talk about there, and given the scale of the concern, it's not obvious that doing sulfate injection is any more available than any of the other contemporary solutions. Second response here is just, remember, Right, this was about feasibility, political feasibility, treacherous notion, in my opinion, what's feasible politically. Here's a picture of the Berlin Wall falling. When I was a kid, everyone said the Berlin Wall will not fall without tremendous bloodshed, right? Without another war. Did. Everyone said apartheid will not fall without a massive civil war and loss of life in South Africa. So I just say political feasibility is a treacherous notion. I don't think we really know what it means and what the constraints actually are there. And my lifetime experience has been the experts on what's politically feasible often get it wrong in a dramatic way. So let's not be too. But then the last thing to say about this general issue of feasibility, even if it's not feasible, right, even if you bite hard on the thing, it's not feasible to do the Global Constitutional Convention, at least the proposal has these virtues. It highlights the depth of the structural problems. Because the argument might be, well, these are our problems. This is what would be required to fix them. And then the rejection is, we can't do what it's required to fix. What's required to fix them. OK. Doesn't mean there's anything wrong with the initial diagnosis or the proposal, right? Not sure there's a lot deeply wrong with the world, but it's not an objection to the proposal yet. And then, of course, this one, which I've mentioned before, think again about if you're at all persuaded by my account of what the problem might be, these worries about feasibility are just going to arise for any proposal that might make a difference, right? So what do you want to do with that? Okay, I'm going to skip over the next one just so we can conclude here. I said the problem was there's a problem of misdiagnosis. The standard analysis of climate change as a tragedy of the commons, I think, is a dangerous mistake. Witness the laugh test. I think part of the danger here is because the misdiagnosis is way too optimistic, right? And it obscures the deep challenges of the tyranny of the contemporary and of this perfect moral storm itself. And though I think the problem has several roots, I think the challenges are driven primarily by institutional failure and especially neglect and crowding out of intergenerational concern. What do I think we should do? Well, I think we, the current generation, needs to take responsibility for addressing the institutional gap. Right? Again, it's kind of a baby step thought, but okay. Then how are we going to do that? Well, I say we need to call for a global constitutional convention focused on future generations, and then those who are interested should try to develop a vision of what the global constitutional convention should look like. And then another further step would be actual concrete proposals that the global constitutional convention should consider, and what are the strengths and weaknesses of those proposals. One key aspect of that last thing, which is not there, the third step, is going to be, for me, is not going to be a sufficient argument against any concrete proposal to say it has weaknesses. Right? Because we have a problem. Right? There are a variety of possible ways of solving it. We need to know about the comparative strengths and weaknesses of each of the proposals. Right? I think we are too inclined to think if we come up with a weakness for a proposal, it must be dismissed. Right? But here's the risk. That might look like a very morally corrupt way of thinking. Thank you.